So we're going to talk today about flattenability in LP framework. So this one means that the norms is not necessarily, it won't be actually Euclidean.
Mm-hmm.
The difference are many. For example, as the first thing to say is that triangles in the Euclidean distance, they have the thing that two triangles, if they have the same lengths on their edges, then they are equal. In LP spaces, this is not true.
Mm-hmm.
So what we want to see is the embedding dimension, as we say. So start with, let's say with Kn over here, a complete graph with n vertices. Mm-hmm. So I say here is an endpoint subset on some LP space means that we have embed this point subset inside some LP space, and we want to see what's the smallest M in order to embed it in LPM. So LPM means, let's write it here, it's just RM as a vector space with a P norm. Okay, we want to find the smallest M. This, the smallest is the embedding dimension. Embedding dimension. Okay, I just want the name in order not to say every time and M. So for example, it's known that we can do it also with the spheres, that for when we have an endpoint subset in the Euclidean space, then we can always embed it in L2M, so in RM. And this is not true in general for LP spaces, because for LP space, as a different way to think about it is that rotations are not isometries in general. So you can rotate a bit and to have some other embedding in some larger LP space that could not be embedded for the smallest M. So we need to treat for every P differently. So let's see, we will start with L infinity here. L infinity is the maximum norm. So when X is a finite dimensional space, is the maximum. When X is okay, so let's put K here and K here. Okay, so this is the maximum norm, and we say that the first result we're going to see is that the embedding dimension of K4 is equal to 2. Okay, so this one is something that is the first result that we can see that's different from the Euclidean case. K4 is this one. If you take all the edges to be equal, then you can see that this one cannot be embedded in two dimensions for the Euclidean space. So M2 of 4 is equal to 3. And but as we can see, Witsenhausen, so that when we have the infinity norm, it can be always embedded in two dimensions. The proof is quite straightforward. Taking the distance function, then you can find the placement, the realization. So you start by a metric space. We know that when we have a finite metric space, then we can always embed it in L infinity. So the distances will use this notation for this one. And since we are just given a distance function space, we can assume by thinking which is or rearranging the x1, x2, x3, x4, we can consider that this sum is the maximum between these three sums. Okay. Now, since we said that we can assume this one, we can define the placement straightforward. So for example, I want to check y1 and y2. So we check in order to find the distance, the maximum of their dimensions. So y21 minus y11 in absolute value is equal to d12. And y21 minus y1 in absolute value is equal to the absolute value of d23 minus d13, which is by triangular inequality smaller from d12. So as you can see, we have achieved that the distance between y2 minus 1 in infinity is equal to d12. If you have all the four point coordinates, then you can play with them in order to see that all the distances are achieved. And so as you can see here, I have just written quickly down the arguments. So the first four are exactly the same as before, as the one that I proved before. So we have only two cases where we use actually the property that d13 plus d24 is bigger from the rest two, right? You see, I had d13 plus d24 is bigger from the rest. And see, it happens also here. Okay, so doing the calculations straightforward in order to see that this is true. Any questions about K4? Are you convinced that I can always embed in two dimensions?
It looks good.
Okay, great. So let's continue to the next one. The next one says that if you have Kn and you have Kn and you manage to put it inside some Lm space, then in order to go to Kn plus one, then you just can do it by just adding one more dimension. Actually, what I said is even stronger from what I'm writing, but that's exactly what I said is exactly what I'm going to prove. I proved that the coning procedure just adds one dimension at most. Okay? So let's see how we're going to prove it. We start by Nn plus one metric space. We have our distance functions. So for some reason here, because I will just have more weird notation, I have put a comma in the notation di comma j would show the distance between pi and pj. But it's the same thing as before. So we start with the first n points, as I said. So the first n points, remember that n is the number for the points and m is the number for the dimension. Okay, so I have put n points in Rm with the infinity norm. Okay, and I have put it isometrically for the first n points of my omega. Okay, and I need to show now that I can put also the next one as long as I am given a slack of one more dimension. Okay, so the coordinates of Pi, remember, is xi1, blah, 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 xim. And now I define Qi, the very same coordinates for the first m coordinates. And for the next one, I'm just putting the distance between the point I and the point pn plus one. Remember, this one is this distance from our metric space omega. Okay, and I do this, of course, for every I that goes from 1 till n. Okay, you can check straight by the triangular inequality, exactly as it happened with Witsenhausen proof, that when I'm talking about the first n points, I have not changed the distances, right? Because if you think the qi minus qj in the n plus 1 coordinate, then this one is di n plus one minus dj comma n plus one, which by the triangular inequality is smaller from di comma j, right? So what I say over here, it is correct. Okay, so I have the nice embedding in L n plus one with the infinity norm. and I need to find a point for the n plus one point of omega. Okay, so I will say that I will take zero the last coordinate in order to achieve all the distance with the rest points. And I need to show that the rest coordinates, I can find the rest coordinates, so I would not exceed these distances. Okay, any questions? So as I say to the undergraduate students, silence means we are happy, unfortunately. So I need to show the existence of these y's. Okay, so if you think about it, what these y's need to show is that they won't exceed, as I said, the distances from the previous points, which means exactly this. I want in the rest coordinates, this is so in the j coordinate, I want the distance between the point pm plus one and pi to have distance smaller from the one that they should achieve in the last coordinate. Okay, and this I wanted, of course, for every coordinate and for every one of the first n points. Okay, so if I gather all these inequalities together, it means that I want for every yj to be the intersection of all these one-dimensional intervals. I would like to say one-dimensional convex subsets. And the reason why I'm talking this is that I'm gonna apply now Kelly's theorem. What says Kelly's theorem? Says let x1, xn be convex subsets of Rd and n to be bigger from d, from d plus one. Then the intersection, then if the intersection of each d plus one intervals, subsets is non-empty, then all the intersections of all the xi's is non-empty. Okay. So here, if you take one dimension, you see I just need to check the d plus one. So my d is equal to one. So I just need to check pairs of intervals if they intersect together. Okay, and if I see that if I take any two pairs, they intersect, and this means that the general intersection is non-empty. So take two such intervals. And since we can draw, we will draw. So we have xij here, and say that we have xkj here. And we have the radius, if you want, of the intervals, the radius around the xi. So by the triangular inequality, if you take the radiuses, this one will be for the first interval and this one will be for the second one. Because if you check, this one is, this point, if you want, over here, is xij plus di n plus one. And this one, and this point over here is xkj minus dj, dk n plus one. Okay, and you see these two things, if I add them together, by the triangular inequality, they are bigger from this distance over here, which means that the two intervals intersect. Okay, since the two intervals intersect, we can find a point, we can choose any point yj over there, and hence we have the embedding. Okay, so this gives us the proof about that coning gives at most one more dimension. Is that clear?
Yeah, that sounds good.
Okay, since we have this one, we can go now to the corollary, which says we know that the embedding dimension with respect to the infinity norm of 4 is smaller or equal from 2. Cone every time, and you will have an upper bound that every time this one is smaller from n minus 2 for the embedding dimension of kn. Okay. So we have a nice upper bound, and we want now to go to lower bounds. Lower bounds. So we'll start with a first result by Witzenhauser. Again, all the results that I will present today for L infinity will be from Witzenhausen. I will show this one in order to simplify the next theorem. So we have a 6-point set over here, and we want to show that its embedding dimension is equal to 4. Okay. So by the previous dimension, we know that it's smaller or equal from 4. So we need to show that it cannot be embedded in 3 dimensions. Okay. So start by any 2 points, a comma b, positive constants that satisfy this property. Okay, and take a partition to omega. Think of it as the union of 2 sets. The first one has 1 triple, and the second one has a second triple. And say that the distances, if you are on the same triple, is equal to b. You see the first 2 cases, if they are on the same triple, is equal to b. Otherwise, is equal to a. So I have a nice sketch also over here with the blue. This is B, and with black, this is A. Okay? So suppose that we have an embedding, an isometric embedding of K6 in 3 dimension space. And then what we can do is that we can translate the sketch in order this point P1 has as first coordinate 0, and we can rotate by 90 degrees only, because there it's size, then it's an isometry only, or we can reflect in order to be sure that P2 has as first coordinate B, and then we don't know. Okay, so if this happens, then we can check for the rest 3 points that since their distance from P1 is smaller or equal from A, we have this one. So their first coordinate is minus 0, should be smaller from A. And the same should happen from the first coordinate from P2, right? So xk minus b should be smaller or equal from A. So if you take these 2, and you will see that xk should lie in this small interval. And I'm saying that this is a small interval because since all of them lying over there, if you take the difference between these 2 points, then their difference is smaller or equal from 2a minus b, right? The biggest possible is 1 to be 1 limit on a and the other to be minus a. So this one is smaller or equal from 2a minus b. But remember that we have that a smaller from b is smaller or equal from 2a. So this number over here, 2a minus b, is smaller from 2b minus b, which is equal to b. Okay, so what does this mean? This means that if you take the distance between these 2 points, it should be equal to b, but it cannot be achieved in the first coordinate. Right, the same for any edge that is in this triangle. Okay, so I cannot achieve it in the first coordinate. Second step is repeat the same argument in the second coordinate. So start with this one. We said that this zero in the first coordinate. Once again, translate now with respect to the second coordinate in order to have this one to be equal to zero. And now take the other point that remains from this triangle. And now this point, say that it should have distance, it should have coordinate B on the second coordinate. Okay, this is the y3 is equal to B. And repeat exactly the same job for the second coordinates. Means these three points should have the same distance from zero, from this point, so it would have that their coordinates in the second coordinates would be inside the same interval, B minus A comma A. So the difference between these two should be always smaller from B. So the distance, once again, cannot be achieved in the second coordinate as well. But there's only one coordinate left, which means that we would have an equilateral triangle, equilateral in the generalized, meaning that the lengths are equal. Okay, we don't say anything about angles. But an equilateral triangle should be embedded in one dimension, and this is not possible, right? Recall that in one dimension, there is no difference between L infinity, L2, L3, L something, right? In one dimension, everything is the same. It's just the observed value. Okay, and this gives us the required contradiction. Okay, so that went well. Any questions? So let's continue. And we continue by thinking about the argument and seeing that we can generalize it for many triples, because if you repeat the same procedure and you start by a complete graph, let's say that n is equal to three k triples, then you can consider once again the metric that you could construct by taking the distances to be equal to b if you are in the same triple, and a if you are in different triples. Same story as before. Do the same trick, and you will see that whenever you achieve the distances in one triangle, that these coordinates are taken from that triple and it cannot be used on the rest triples. So every triple needs two additional dimensions. So this means that our embedding dimensions should be bigger or equal from 2k. Okay. And now, as a corollary, just using the fact of coning, as we said before, we can show that for every n, we know that we have a lower bound of the integral part of 2n over 3. Okay, so as a remark, from what we said, we had proved that m infinity of 6 is equal to 4. From what we said, it's proven that m infinity of 5 is equal to 3. But it's still open, for example, if the embedding dimension of k7 is equal to 4 or 5. We don't know. So I think that's what I wanted to say about L infinity. Any questions about that before I go forward to LP spaces?
Looks good.
Okay, good. So next time I will come back to L infinity and I will talk about forbidden minors over there or about large dimensions with L infinity. So let's continue now for LP spaces. Once again, I'm going to talk first about upper bounds. And I define here the distance matrix with the p distances, right? So if you are given a configuration, sorry, if you are given a realization of the vertices in some LPM space, LPM means once again Rm with the LP norm, then this takes this realization and gives us the p powers of the p norms. Okay? And the m-dimensional configuration space is the image of the realizations in LPM. This one should be up here. Okay, and I'm taking that the general configuration space is the union of all the m-dimensional configuration space. I think that Son has also talked about these things. I'm not gonna talk a lot about the same things. I just want to add some parts. So I will define by KP to be the intersection of the configuration space with the hyperplane that the sum of all the coordinates gives equal to one. And now I'm gonna talk about things that also Son has talked, so I'm gonna go pretty quickly. So I want to say that the configuration space is always a convex cone, and it's also the convex hull of the one-dimensional configuration space. As Keith Ball says, the convex hull of the linear configuration points. Okay, I like the word linear, so I may use it sometimes. Remember, when I'm saying this, I mean that here I have the one-dimensional configuration space. Okay, just in order to repeat, because I feel concerned, this M for the one-dimensional comes that I am from realizations that are in the m-dimensional. So this means that these are the configuration points who have realizations in one dimension. Okay, and as I said, we have seen this before. In order to show that it's a cone, you start with, I can show that even every m-dimensional configuration space is a cone. Start with a point, find one realization in m dimensions. Then for every lambda positive, you can take this realization, lambda to one over p of x, just work with the norms in order to see that this one would give as a configuration point lambda delta. Okay, so we proved that every CPM, every m-dimensional configuration space is a cone, so their union is also a cone. Okay, the next one is, we will show that it's the convex hull. Everything inside the configuration cone lies inside the convex hull of the linear configuration points. Once again, Son has shown this one before. So you start with a configuration point. You find for that configuration point a realization in the given M space. So you have M coordinates here, and you are taking the projections at each coordinate. So each I gives the I coordinate projection. For each projection over here, you take an one-dimensional realization, which will give a configuration point delta I that lies, of course, in the one-dimensional configuration space. And now if you take the convex combination of this delta I by this M over here, is just, we just add it in order to show that it's a convex combination. It's not something we multiply it in the projection, and we divide it by this again in order to have the nice convex combination over there. But you can see that this convex combination will give back delta. So delta would be a convex combination of M and one-dimensional configuration points. Okay, and that proves that the configuration space lies inside the convex hull of its one-dimensional configuration points. So it suffices to show that the configuration space is convex. Okay, and once again, this is done before. We have two points inside the configuration space. There exists an M. Take the largest one of the two, where both can be embedded. So we have that delta one and delta two lie in some M configuration space. Take a convex combination between the two. And then you can define, sorry, take the convex combination, and you want to define a realization in some LP space that would have as a configuration point at delta. Since delta one and delta two lie in the m dimension configuration space, they can be written as images of two realization, x1 and x2. And now giving these two, we can define this realization in LP to M. Remember that I can take LP direct sums over here. So say x1, x2 has P norm to be equal to P of the norm of x1, P to the P plus x2, P to the P. And that's how we embed LPM inside LP to M. And if you do the calculation, you can see that this delta is just the configuration point that corresponds to the realization X. Okay, so we have proven that CP is convex. Okay, and as a corollary of this, we can take Boll's result. Boll proved it in a different way, but I thought that this would work fine. So start by the intersection of the configuration space with that given hyperplane. And if you think about it, this one is a convex space that is a half n times n minus one dimension space. Because if you think about it, since the image that I have is r to the number of the edges, this one is 1 over 2n times n minus 1, and I subtract 1 because I have taken intersection with the hyperplane. Okay, so I have an this dimensional convex space, and now Karathodori's theorem says that when I have this one, this can be written with at most the number that you are given plus 1, so here we'll have a half n times n minus one plus one. So these two would cancel each other. So a half times nine n times n minus one points that lie inside the linear configuration points, exactly because the linear configuration points create a cone as well. They would intersect with this hyperplane. Okay, so we have the result that we want. So are we happy?
Could you just remind me what Kp Kn was again?
Yes. So Kp of G in general is...
I think you've probably gone past it.
Yeah, okay. Okay, Kp of G in general is the configuration space intersection with the hyperplane.
Okay.
So we have the linear combination that we have from the one dimensionals. And since the one dimensions are a cone, we can scale them in order to cross that hyperplane. And over there, it will be a convex combination.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah, okay. Then we use that. Okay. All right. I think I follow it now. All right. Cheers.
Okay. So we're going now to lower bounds. Okay. For LP spaces, before we had every LP space from one up to infinity. For infinity, we have Witsenhausen's results. So we are pretty much good. Okay, and these were upper bounds. So we're going now to lower bounds from one up to two. Okay, and now the first thing that we're gonna work is actually for rule one. Okay, so I want to start with the lemma, which has just calculations between real numbers in order to give an inequality. I'm not gonna go through the proof because it's just do all the calculations, no rigidity over there. or no embeddability there. It's just do the calculations. So please, I would ask you to believe me that this one is true every time, and it is inequality whenever I have these properties. I don't need you to remember them now. I will just use them when I will use them in the next proof. Okay, so this is just a numerical result that will be useful in what's coming. Okay, so, and see what's coming. This one says that the embedding dimension of Kn in L1 is bigger or equal from 1 over 2 n minus 2 times n minus 3. Okay, and let's see how Keith Ball proved that one. It had some great idea about finding functionals, separating functionals between the spaces. So let's check what's happening. So because I don't want to repeat every time this a half times nine n minus two times n minus three, I'm just gonna call it k. It's much easier. And I will index the coordinates of L1k by this. Okay, as long as you try to see what this means, I will do an example because I think that it's easier. So say that n is five. So k is actually three. So L1 of three, I would need to think of them as three coordinates where the first coordinate would be, okay, this equality here doesn't seem okay. The indexes that I want is first coordinate would be 2, 3, second coordinate would be 2, 4, and third coordinate would be 3, 4, right? I'm starting from 2. The second coordinate should always be bigger from the first one. And I need to go up to 4 over here. Okay, so I have these three indices for the coordinates. And this is for my xn, my realization. So in order to give you a nice example, I will just try to write it. So I will just try to write, for example, for n equal to 5 again. So start from x1, it's 0, 0, 0. I know that x5 would be 0, 0, 0. Okay, this is the first coordinate. So this is the 2, 4 coordinate. This is the 3, 4 coordinate. And this is, sorry, this is the 2, 3 coordinate. This is the 2, 4 coordinate. And this is the 3, 4 coordinate. Okay, happy with this? So it's time to see what's the realization in the rest. So x2 of 2, 3. So you see my I for x2 is 2. So if I is equal to R or S, so for 2, 3, it's equal for 2, so it's going to be 0 here. For 2, 4, it's once again equal to 2, to the first coordinate, so it's going to be 0 here. And for 3, 4, it's equal to 1, because 3, 4 is nothing, no digit equal to 2. Similarly, for x3, it's going to be 0 here, because it has this digit equal. 2, 4 has no digit equal to 3. And 0 here. And similarly, we'll have 1, 0, 0. Okay, so are we happy with the way that the configuration works and the whole indexing and of the coordinates? Great, I saw a thumbs up. So I continue. So we have that configuration X that had these points, in our case was 5. Okay, and this one of course gives a configuration point delta X by taking the, are we in L1? So we're taking the L1 distances in the first power. So just the L1 distances. Okay, and as we did before, we will take the projection to its dimension. So the dimensions here are indexed, the coordinates, if you want, are indexed by this 2, 3, 2, 4, 3, 4, by the RS that I wrote before, right? So this one, delta RS, is just the one dimensional Sorry, I was looking here. I want the point one. Yeah, the one-dimensional, the one-dimensional configuration points of of our given KN that derive from taking the coordinates of our realization X. Okay, and here it says, so the values, if you take them, would be this one. So I will just write down what happens in our case for delta to three. If you do the calculation, you will see that delta to three of 1, 2, which means that on the coordinate 2, 3, I'm taking the distance between x1 and x2 would be 0. Delta 2, 3, 1, 3 would be 0 again. Delta 2, 3, 1, 4 would be 1. Delta 2, 3 of 1, 5 would be equal to 1 again. Delta 2, 3 of 2, 3 would be 0. Delta 2, 3 of 2, 4 is equal to 1, and so on. I guess you understand where is this going. So we'll have 0 and 1s only. And check now that if I check only the ij's, okay, then this one says that it's equal to 1 if the ij's, how can I say it? If I check the ij's and only one of them would be equal to 1 r or s. Okay, if I take the ij's and only one of them is equal to 1 r s. So if I consider, for example, this point over here, I see that 1 is one of the 1 r s because it's the 1, and 2 is my r over here. So I have both of them to be here while I want precisely 1. So this one should be 0. D2313, once again, 1 is one of the 1RS and 3 is over here, so it's 0. If I go to 1, 4 now, you see that 4 is nothing of 1 to 3, so that's why I'm taking 1. That's a different way to see it. As I said, I calculated first from doing the calculations and finding the delta, and then I'm taking the projections. And then I saw that this formula holds. And now this formula that holds with the 1RS over there will give us the idea, because if you remember, that's what the lemma said, that I want this to be equal, otherwise I want the rest to be equal with something else. Okay, so we are in the case that this lemma would work, and that's what we're gonna do. Taking advantage of that lemma, we'll define on the configuration space, not exactly in the configuration space, in the linear space that contains the configuration space, we'll define this linear functional. Okay, so for every delta, I will take the coordinates that would come up from there. And and so it follows now from the previous lemma that phi of delta is negative. It's negative whenever I have phi of delta, sorry, it's negative every time for every configuration point, and it's equal to zero. Sorry, and whenever I have a one-dimensional configuration point, then it's equal to zero, exactly by our lemma, when I have these multiples of delta RS. That's an infinite leaf case. Okay, so this linear function separates our points, our configuration points, if you want. So if I have a configuration point, I can check if phi of that configuration point is equal to zero, if and only if that delta is a linear combination, and since we are in a cone, a positive linear combination of these delta RSs. Okay, so for example, phi of delta x is equal to zero because that delta x was just the sum of delta RSs. Okay. And now we want to show that X cannot be embedded in L1 K minus 1. Okay, suppose this would be the case that it can be embedded. Okay, so if you think about it, since it can be embedded, as we've proven before, then can be analyzed to K minus 1 points, linear points if you want, K1 one-dimensional configuration points. Okay, but as we said, phi of delta x is equal to 0, right? So as I said before, this means that the terms for the one-dimensional points would be the delta RSs. And the reason is that if there were other points, other one-dimensional points, then for those points, phi would give a negative number. And since we have a positive linear combination, this would mean that phi of delta x would also be a negative number, right? Which is cannot happen. So this means that the combination would have at most k minus one of the specific delta RSs. Okay, that's the importance of that functional over there. Okay, so since we have k minus one, there is one that should not appear in that expression of delta x. Okay, so we know that delta x can be written as a linear combination of the rest k minus one, which does not have the delta w. But we saw that delta x can be written as a sum of all these delta RSs. So inside there is also the delta tau u, and has also a coefficient one, which means that there is a linear dependence over there. Linear dependence over there, meaning that I could add them all together and add some coefficients. Lambda t u, as we said, since here does not have a coefficient zero, it has coefficient equal to one, means that lambda tu would be different from zero. Okay, so I can take the sum of all of this, and since I have the linear dependence, this should be equal to zero for specific lambda RSs. Okay, and now since I have this equation, I can define the functional, once again, the configuration space, phi tu, okay, and would be delta tn plus delta un minus delta tu. So I will just take the three that I want. If you go to calculate for delta tu, then you will take one over here and one over here, because exactly it has one to be the same. And here one to be the same. So it would be one plus one. Here they are both the same, so it's zero. We want precisely one. So this one would be equal to two. But if I take anything else would have either tu, either t or u or nothing as the same as the above. So for sure, one of these two would be equal to zero, and the other would be the same as it is with the minus. Okay, so one of these two is zero, and the other would be plus the same, minus the same, so it's gonna be zero. So every time this one would be zero. So if I apply now FTU on two, this FTU separates my delta RSs over here, because it's gonna send everything to zero apart from delta TU, right? So it will give two times lambda TU. And on the right-hand side, of course, since it's linear, it's gonna give zero. Okay, so this would be a contradiction because we said that lambda tu is different from zero. Okay, and that's the main proof here. So some remarks. If we go to low dimensions, we see that M1 of 4, the embedding dimension of K4 is equal to 2. And it's an easy way to see it because L1 of 2, sorry, the two-dimensional L1 is actually the same space with L infinity, with the two-dimensional infinity. This holds only for the first and the second dimension for one and infinity. If you go any higher than that, this is not the same. Okay, and by having other ideas, some as Keith Paul says, some ad hoc techniques can give that M1 of 5 is equal to 3, but M1 of 6 is equal to 6. So this one is quite bigger from 2 and from M infinity. Right. So that's a big difference over there. And finally, do a similar proof is with the above can give an upper for every P that lies in 1, 2. And for every N bigger equal from 2, from 3. Okay, so a similar argument works for P spaces where P is between 1 and 2. The argument is pretty similar by saying that you will take a lemma with an arithmetic inequality, which is quite peculiar, but would come up from a functional that would separate the points, the one-dimensional points of our configuration. Okay, and I think that, yeah, this is it for today. So any questions?
So from what I understand, the only one where we have a tight bound is L2, right?
Yes.
Okay. And is there a conjecture for the and the gap between the lower bound and the upper bound is quite high for infinity, right?
Yeah. Yeah, but there is no better conjecture, I think, over there from what I've seen.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that Fiorini et al. Have given any new bounds, but I don't think so. I have not seen anything else.
And for L1, the gap is something like N or something, approximately.
So
yeah, the upper bound is N minus.
The upper bound is this one.
No, this is the lower bound, right?
Sorry, the lower bound.
Yeah.
The upper bound, I think that's the general one, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
So the gap is something like N or so, approximately.
Yeah.
So are you going to talk about other graphs besides KN?
Yes, I'm going to talk about minors the next time.
Okay.
Okay, so as I said, I will focus on the Fiorini et al. 2 papers. So I'm pretty sure that I will do a full proof for the wheel graph. And I will show some graphs in big dimensions that are not embeddable.